before I got that little book that says understanding the times, and you can open it up a little bit. And I didn't start to see this morning. There are moments in a church's life that are defining moments. So they really could be in the day. And the reason is this. What we're going to talk about for the next few minutes is having a scheme of the enemy, and the scripture tells us not to be in the way of the schemes of the enemy. You know what an enemy is, you say, right? You know, the enemy is trying to take you away from what it is that God has called you to do, and why you were created, and why you set out to do this big deal. And what we're going to talk about for the next few minutes is so important, because I don't know about you, but does the world is going to look to you? I don't know what they're doing. You may say she's a little bit too uncertain. Isn't the danger? I think one of the major schemes of the enemy is to get you isolated. Is to get you alone. Is to get you separated. See, let's go all the way back to the beginning of the story. Genesis 2:18 says this. The Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. And the woman said, amen. The new word that you're going to hear more than Jesus here is going to be this word, relationships. It is all about relationships, and it always has been. You know what God's goal is? Relationship. He wants a relationship with you, his creation. We keep spreading it out to the mind. We keep calling it, and what does it do? He just receives it from you. We rebuild the deep as you do. Jesus went along and said, why? Because he had a relationship with you. It's a love about relationships. We were made for relationships. That's the first thing I'm saying in the book there. We were made for relationships. Not just relationships with our time. How many of you know some people who are more people than like you? Come on. While the 12-year-old dealt with the 32-year-old teacher. Generation, do you see it? But what have we done? We split them up into great. Television. Anybody remember three channels? Come on, somebody. You're really good, right? Three channels, right? Anybody know the perfect? What is that? Yeah, are you better making the stand there holding the chair? Okay, it's just going to say, stand right there. And here's what happened. Back in the day, the family would get together and watch a TV show together. And you hear me? You got 400 channels. Come on. If you want, you just have to watch a watching channel for like-minded people with a study when they focus on the TV. Right? 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 It's broken and down into this thing. And the study is for you. I need to grow this. But this is not an accident, this is not a thing, but this is just an agenda here. social media, social media is just a confirmation bias. What is confirmation bias? I continue getting what I like. I continue confirming what I think is good, right? I'm thinking about it. Getting one yesterday. This is happening yesterday. Getting one anywhere from me. And I'm sitting in my chair in my feet up, and she's sitting on the couch, and she's all this and that. And she got a girlfriend on me. And she's on my phone. How do you know a word teaches it in different words? Why? Because that's a word, and all the boys are thinking, oh, I'm just me what I want. And I'm just her what she wants. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So oftentimes we'll talk about how different our videos are, right? Mine is like so blown up, and hers are like kittens or some weird stuff. You know what I mean? Let's see it. The thing is that and less emotionally taxing to stay with your pain. Does that make sense to anybody? But I'm going to start connecting with this. Please don't hear this as a point for you to stress. Might as well, it's a point for the rest of us. But we've got 365 plus communities. Why? Because we're trying to get away from the place of truth. That's where that's a point for my kids more than it is on them. Come on, right? Why don't you believe on those things? I want you to watch the segmentation that is going on with our culture. We need to go and see what is going on and why is all this mess going on. I want to see your thoughts. Who was the station priest? Now, priest is a different word. And priest, as a matter of fact, with a Greek word that particularly means to be a liar, and it refers to preaching. Some of you have heard back in the day somebody would call you a preacher. That's what we're supposed to preach, and the efforts to preach. That they were not a good people. They were liars, and they were manipulators. But they decided to launch a church, and then make some churches and preach, and some other like house church types, and some other like. And they were having some problems. So Paul writes to Titus, listen to me, in chaos. These are his instructions. I just wonder if they get the right to us from this. Titus 2:1. Therefore, you teach what? Observe with sound doctrine. Every man are to be sober-minded, dignified, self-controlled, sound in faith, in love, and in steadfastness, and consistency. Older women likewise are to be reverent in behavior, not slanderous, or slaves to too much wine. They are to teach what is good, so train the younger women to love the husbands and children. To be self-controlled, poor, working at home, kind, and submissive to their own husband, that the work of the Lord may be reviled. Likewise, urge the younger men to be self-controlled. As the same, this is my teaching. Again, show yourself in all respects to be a model of good work in your teaching for integrity, dignity, and thanksgiving for confidence in you, so that an opponent may be picked to stand, having nothing evil to say about us. Right, Paul's system or plan for the Christian problem? The generations getting together. See, we don't just do social media to worship because it's cheap. We don't just have the kids coming here just because we just want to push the kids to other ones in life. Right? We don't just do it just to get our kids ready for your break. It does. It's just fantastic for me. But no one will listen to me. You right now are participating in the deep place of six generations get together in our culture. It's you. You're participating, or I believe, this morning in something that flanks a theme of the enemy. Are you hearing me? This is spiritual warfare that is going on here this morning. Putting up with the praying baby, putting up with the 5-year-old running down the aisle, listen to me. This is spiritual warfare here this morning. Because it's much easier just to say what I can. You see, the part of the Timothy at some point, 1 Timothy 5:11. Do not rebuke an older man, which is talking to the younger man, us younger men. It's coming up. Do not exalt yourself, right? That's my thing. Do not rebuke an older man, but encourage them as you were a father. Don't rebuke another woman, you encourage them as you would a father. Younger men as daddies, older women as mothers, younger women as sisters, in all purity. Do you hear it? in the world. We're supposed to be generationally minded. Our very purpose, we many of you know the story, but very purposely, oneness of all these countries between us. And those of you know that I'm Mr. Water was one of our questions about what's the state. Probably one of the biggest human events in my life. And I love him to death for it. But you really want to say it to you. He would say things to me that I would just be like, Mr. Water, are you serious right now? Right? And then I would just go my way, knowing that man was right. And he's talking to me. But I had to push him to that relationship. I want to challenge us this morning to think if we're going to be, let me go back to the first chapter. And the children of Israel, we need to have understanding of dependence. To know what Israel ought to do. All right, let me give you an understanding of dependence. We live in a time of six generations that have been segmented so that we are struggling to live as God has called us to live. The older needs to be younger. That's the biblical model. Understanding the challenge will be understanding that God has given us different generations to help God. But we don't need to gender generation dancing. Come on, young people, boomer. Come on, all of you, all of you, some millennials. Good Lord. Come on. Why do you think to me when you do that? Can I tell you, you are participating with the enemy. And God has called us to come together. Because if we don't, let me read what happened in the Bible in Joshua 2 and 10. After that whole generation had been better to the ancestors, another generation grew up who neither knew the Lord nor what he had done for us. Come back to the great country to me. If the church doesn't step up and do the church. If we don't become the salt and light, that Jesus called us to become, and you hear what I'm saying to you. If we're going to understand the times, that means we're understanding the generation. So let's have a little fun. Here we go. You ready? If you were born between 1928 and 1945, would you keep saying? Would you say what? 1945? Really right. We got a silent generation. Come on, get in the hand this morning. You guys can have a seat. Thank you so much. Those are the builders, the silent generation, the builders, right? And just so you might, just in case you see, here's a few famous people, good and bad, it's my opinion, but here's a few famous people from that generation. You might recognize some folks. You might not recognize some folks. I'm not going to tell you, it's on you. But here's another thing, let's talk about their slang. What are the slang words of the building? Well, I'll just put in here, I'll read some first time to English, if you please. It's pretty much true. Come on, now, that's a good kind of work. And here's what I want you to know, this is from this generation. What would be their life paradigm or the narrative of their life? Be grateful you have a job. Be grateful you have a job. Why? Because the traumatic events of their life, the Great Depression, followed by World War II. Come on, somebody. And these folks, I remember my mommy talking about eating tomato sandwiches every day. Right? Just to survive. Come on, if you get a lot of dairy, don't waste food. My grandmama, she would finish my plate if I didn't finish it. Anybody else? Yeah, and I always thought, like, you didn't think that it was getting children, right? It's getting great. Like, what are you doing? Right? If you think you have to, right? They don't get things. Shut the door. Are you going to see the entire neighborhood here? Anybody ever heard this one? Yeah. Hey, hey, hey. They are the kind of people that save Christmas wrapping paper. Right? But listen to me, why? Not because they're crazy, but because of what they lived through in the middle of it, you hear me? Right? The Great Depression, World War II, Mr. Ryan was in the same year. Think about the value that they bring to us. There's a couple of lessons I think babies would like for us to grow. Number one, take personal responsibility from the men. Be stable. Be humble. Love loyally. What that means? Their divorce rate was the lowest of all of our generation. Right? Love loyally. Work hard. Embrace failure. Don't let life so complicated. This generation has done some great things to teach you. If you don't know a building, you're missing out. Are you hearing me? You need a building in your life. You need somebody in your life to come from a completely different country to speak it in your life into you. Oh, here we go. Stand back to you were born between 1946 and 1964. Here we go. Look around. Give it up for the baby boomers in the house today. Look at that. See that boom? Look how many of them there are. Holy mackerel, do you know why there's so many of them talking? Do you know why? Here's why. Let's do this thing. 9 months after World War II, the maternity wards were very similar to that. Then came along, and I'm saying, think of this. 76 million kids were born in 18 years. Anyway, here are some famous baby boomers. You might remember some famous kids. Right? No judgment. Just some famous baby boomers. Right? You know that? Most of them. All right, here's some of those things. They didn't have fun. Here's some of those things. D.K., D.K., Reason, and Ray Austin. Right? Okay? If you're there like paradigm, different paradigm than the building, different paradigm than their parents, I deserve better. I deserve better. See, what happens is they come out of this nothingness of their family before them, right? What was in the purpose of the World War II and all this, and they said, no, 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 we're going to do this better. This is the time of expansion, not depression. Right? McDonald's versus. McDonald's was franchising. Shopping malls were popping out. It was the time of being let go big. Let's talk about generation of going through. What are the traumatic events for this generation? KF pays this information. The Berlin Wall went up. And so the Cold War began. Civil rights crisis around, right? And the madness of all that. And then the biggest of all, and that's the Vietnam War. Right? It was all that. It was all that. So what value can a boomer bring you? Experience. Life experience can compare the times in their youth. The fullness of pitfalls to avoid and the life placement. We got to stop saying boomer as a negative and you start looking for a boomer coming in your life. Why? Because it's just a bit of a sinner when you're doing what I'm saying to you. Is there those in your life? Take your mic. I feel like I'm in a sociology class today. No, it's just because it's to understand the community. I don't think we're understanding. Only want you to go boomer. Do you mean when people see my words that speak into your life and speak into your heart? And I promise you, as many times as I rolled my eyes at Mr. Wilder, he was right most of the time. Stand up if you were born between 1965 and 1980. Were you like Jim Ashley? So, Genesis coming out, yes, I'm a Genesis as well. All Genesis, you know how to speak. Their generation started Texas with the public introduction of the birth control pill. So, instead of a boomer baby, we had a bus. That's what sometimes they're called the bus series. Instead of 76 million children, only 46 million children were born during this time period. In 1973, Roe versus Wade came in and we had abortion. Right? So now we have this shrinking population, a whole different thing that they are living for. Here are some famous genetics. You may not recognize all of them. Some of their families, dude. I say that all the time. Like I was living in the city, laughing at all the time. Dude, wrong. I don't say that much on that. I don't remember it. Richard, if he got a baby, that's Richard. I mean, as if. right? As if, here's the right paradigm question. Keep it real. Keep it real. Why? Well, by the 1960s, there was a Vietnam War going on, and it was on television. That's a whole new world for us, right? Like the new generation is dealing with seeing everything, being in one of the right now. This is the first time people are seeing this stuff, and the first time that the reality of war was seen on television. The president was saying that everything was okay, but it didn't even look so okay. Why did that happen? Now you have a Democrat and a Republican running in the White House. There was a very real wall of skepticism that went up to the house of the United States because we were seeing that the adults were speaking negatively because of what was going on. Lots of us were left to kids. And divorce began to rise in our culture in our time. Traumatic events, Watergate, challenges, disaster, Operation Desert Storm. And this is going to be the value that you're coming from the direction. Realism, authenticity, balance, pragmatic wisdom, resourcefulness, and now the heart of the current workforce. As we know, we're going to 1981 and 1995, where are you? And you're going to go in the house. Yeah, give it up to the man. As you know, this is another thing. There are some famous millennials. I always like to start to get real hard on them. But if you do that with your wife, I can put the names up on the front of them. Millennials, whatever you like. The sound of millennials, brainy, funky, dope, just people, whatever, right? Right paradigm, Texas, this is important. If you want to learn something and you're going to speak better to your kids and grandkids, you're paying attention to really listen to this. Right paradigm, life is a temperature. Life is a temperature. See, millennials go at it like life is a buffet. I think a little bit of that, a little bit of that, a little bit of that. Right? And so, that's the way that millennials are great at customizing their lives. They no longer have to buy CDs and records like we did, right? They have customized playlists, right? They might go to three or four different colleges, maybe one overseas. So life became different for them. So for an older generation, it's like, put your head down, grind, do your job, baby. This is what they're doing. And you hear what I'm saying? Different, not wrong. Different, not wrong. Right? Traumatic events. Oh, let me give you a couple more. That's the spirituality. Spirituality is the capacity. I take a little Buddha, a little bit of Jesus, doing a little something to have, like, that's another way that a lot of the members feel today. The fewest entrepreneurs of any of the generations. Because she's doing just one thing and holds me back. From being able to do the cafeteria. So now it's a bit to go on like social media. That's a bad idea for most of it. Right? Because all of a sudden, you begin to compare your life to everybody else's all day from cafeteria. Call them down. You know that this group had the biggest spike of divorce in the history of our country? Right? They were living through the biggest spike of divorce in our country. Desert Storm and then 9/11. Listen to me about the value of believing. Confidence, energy, tech savvy, good social, it's a good kind of social, it's a good social creature, creativity, optimism, good innovation, it's a good way to the world tomorrow. Right? An awareness of their influence. They're aware that you influence other people, like no other generation before us. Can I be the one between 1996 and 2020? Between 1996 and 2020. Come on, get me in the house! Get me a rabbit from the United States. I said, get me in. And sometimes they're called homelanders. You know why they're
It's on borders, buses, others, homelanders. You know why they call homelanders? Because the Department of Homeland Security started doing regulations. Put that in there. Here's some famous things here. Now you start to worry about things that are old, right? Right? When you can recognize and know any of these particular folks. Some slang from our good years, Seth. Cap. Drip. Dingy. And rude. Older folks. Older folks. Please listen to the Pentagon on my back for me. Right there, then. A good year. I'm hoping and hoping. This is a stressed-out generation. This is an anxious generation. This is the result of nothing social media in my life. I don't know any different, but smartphones and all this information coming out all of the time. And that those who saw Vietnam on TV were shocking. They get them all day long, every day, 365. 24/7. Some of the dramatic events have been two shootings. One year there were more generations, but there were more school shootings than babies. And you realize that. Pandemic happened. George Floyd and the 2016 election and the recession. But here's what gives me that I'm going to give some value. Ready? Confidence. Right? The reality that they are, and it's a lot like the millennials, right? So they're top stuff, like creating the optimism. This is for me. This is for me to do. Because they're anxious, but they have ability, they can have a tendency to be a little sexier, and it's hard to understand. And for us in another generation, we're really struggling a bit with this generation. And you have to understand the things. Oh, I've got to keep moving when you're not coming. But if you can stand up, and you were born between 2011 and 2025, not yet, stand up. Right? I heard them out. Jim Alpha is in the hall, and this is Brady. This is my run for president. It's still got me all right. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Just to put it in perspective, you said that beginning 2011 and 2010, I have one. Right? I don't hear this from Virginia Alpha and Mr. Jim Alpha. You are two famous Jim Alpha. Do you know what you're doing, Mr. Jim? And then the other one, King George. One day, right? Prince George, third in line to the King of England. Yes? The other one, you may or may not know her. Why do you take more her? She goes by Nastia. I'm going to try to say her name. She was born in the Russia. Anastasia Sergeyevna Razvinskaya. She's a 9-year-old Russian American YouTuber who has the 5th most viewed and the 7th most subscribed to channel in the world. She has 114 million subscribers. She made $3.1 million a year at 90 years old. That's right. And this is the thing, I just want you to understand, like, that's a lot of record. That's a lot of stuff. Come on, y'all. Like, hopefully, mom and dad are doing that well, but that's a lot. Here's a little explosion for men, you may not know these. The phantom tax. I'm going to see that. That's awesome. Very painful and loving. Joe, most of us know Joe, right? Joe, for those of you. Rachel, Dick, Buzzy, and Lord. You can look them up. And here's the thing. This is the old folks in my life. This is the thing. This is what I have to do. I just need to find what generation your grandkids are. I want to look up these words because you can just Google them and I'll give you the definition. I want you to start slipping them in the conversation. Come on, man. Come on. You know what I'm going to do, right? But hey, when I walk through these, did you notice a pattern? Let me tell you back to you because you may not have noticed. Boomers were cautious. Boomers were confident. Gen X was cautious. Millennials confident. Gen Z cautious. So we expect Gen X to have confidence. If you raise the millennials, you might as well just say, you might not be the president at 25 years old. But with Jason, you have to say, you can do this, I believe in you. But we need to know and understand and know what to do. How do we make sure that we're having a relationship with God designed to be in the world that has worked very hard to isolate us? This world is trying to isolate us. We don't want to say this to you first. We need to embrace the offer and take it. And then, we've got to stop fighting ourselves. We've got to stop avoiding it and push in. But as we do, we want to do some tactics for the relationship. Right? We're going to need some tactics because every generation looks at authority different. Let me tell you how we look at authority different. David, respect it. Boomers, replace it. Right? Boomers is going to take over and be the new authority. Generations, ignore it. Millennials, choose it. Jesus, not really sure I need it. I just want you to see the reality of what's going on around us to understand the times. Now, what are we doing? That's not what we're going to do. There's a very human factor about my way. I'm going to do something to my phone. You've heard me talk about doing biblical leadership and leadership training with kids. We're using a program called Habitude. How many of you have the Habitude? So you're going to see what a lesson looks like. I'm going to give you a very brief version, but I want to use it. He says, well, how do we take this information and we can actually do something with it? Well, how do we actually put this into work? And even though it's Romans 12, 4 through 6, for just as each of you has one body with many members, and these members do not have all the same functions, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts. Please, somebody say different. Different gifts. According to the grace God given to us. So here's the first habitude I'm going to teach you this morning. Second judges. Second judges. If you had a box of chess and a box of chesses, and you open it up and you pull out the game board, what would you know? They look the same. First the same game, right? No, because they're only in the place, so what are you going to notice? The pieces look different in this one. See, here's the problem. Most of us are called chesses. We're expecting everybody to play the same game the same way. We're not getting interaction with like God has created different. Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? When you learn chess, you got to learn this one to do this and it can't be that. This one to go up in 7 ways. This one to go down in 1 way. This one to listen to me. It's 2 generations. You know what's happening in businesses today? In churches, in schools? There's a whole lot of leaders who are playing chess when they need to be playing chess. Maybe ask kids, come on, what about you? How hard are you playing with your kids, with your grandkids, with your crazy millennials that work if you work with? There's 4 generations in the workplace right now. And it is just kind of interesting. So, mediocre leaders play chess. That's not the order because everyone is the same. And you know. So, let me give you 4 things that you never get together about the different generations of lives at work. All are in your family. One is, we need to know the strengths and weaknesses. We need to know them a little bit and understand the strengths and weaknesses. It's all about relationships. Let me tell you, there's triggers. I don't mean just what triggers in a free soul, I mean what motivates them. What are they motivated? What is it that tells us? When you want to get a millennial motivated, start talking about connecting from social power to the workplace. Right? We're gonna have this coffee. James is giving the new restaurant open up downtown, right? They're just building. Their coffee comes from Hope Coffee, right? Their coffee comes from Hope Coffee. Hope Coffee does missions, right, in other countries. So they're all excited about things like that. And you don't even say anything. And they're brilliant. They're going to get to know their personality. This is not something. They're going to have to say that they don't think that they're going to do. Number 4. These are the familiar learning styles. Everybody loves books. These are the things that I'm getting to teach the kids that I'm teaching you this morning. They're deep towards these years. Why? The research says that James here used to see a vision and have emotion called to the vision and then they're in the brain. It's a learning style. So, we give them these pictures, inside, and the Revelation 2. What it says is in the second. Ephesians 6 is called, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the power of the dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. Your battle is not against the rulers. Your battle is not against the demon in that story. Your battle is a spiritual one. Bringing the spirit of the Bible. So let me talk to you about a spirit of victory. 30,000 Greeks came to fight 40,000 Romans. Can you picture it? It was the battle of Aspen. And two spirits of the Romani. And they fought, 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 for days after days, and weeks after weeks, and finally the Romans got to elevate. They broke through and they won. And get killed. Red Man Man comes through. Lifts over the battlefield. The great victory came. And he says this. Three more victories for Christ and it's going to be the real one. Because we have dead men within us. And we're going to be in the same thing. This is the news. You may have won the battle. But look at you losing the process. With anyone else, especially someone of a different generation, can I encourage you not to win a court with you? She's got every one of us is going to make a decision in this family. You must decide which is more important, number one, your relationship, or number two, your results. In business, sometimes the result has to be. But most of the time in your family, listen to me, the relationship. Don't win church victories. 2 Timothy 2:25. The only strength goes to the place of truth. The heart of God returns those to the heart. And they will learn the truth. Gently instruct. Here's the heart of truth in your teaching eyes. Children and vampires. Children and vampires both draw blood. But there's a right way to offer feedback and criticism to people. Vampires suck the life blood out of a person. Operating from their own needs. Children speak medical conditions carefully and constructively. Both draw blood and they lead to different outcomes. So if you're going to offer feedback, from a place of relief. In other words, I'm relieving myself. I'm relieving my own thinking. I'm gonna break it, and you're gonna know it. Is it from a place of relief? I've been with some issues. I'm living with successive ways that does not produce relief. The last one in the page. The single five is five. In the same way, you who do a leader must accept the authority of the Lord. I follow you, dress yourself in humility as you relate to one another. There's a lot of places in God that the great true gentleman of Israel has seen my life in the close. And that is a bridge in the way. And the person of the bridge is the way. Let's go through this one. Why don't you start looking at your connection with other generations? As a symbiotic leadership. We look at the words of God and the generations together that we might learn from one another and become the body of Christ and be called us to be so we do reparation and renewal and rebuild the community. You know what I'm saying? So it's not the magic. What do you always do when you see one another? Is it about the kids? Is it about the grandchildren? Is it about getting more involved here in church with the younger generations? No, with the new generation. Is it about something that we should bring to the center of your country today? Because it opens up what God's calling us to do. Can we build you to serve another generation? Can you look with me for opportunities to serve, love, and discern, listen to me, grow, trust, God, suffering from the human condition. Let me pray that Father has a prayer to pray with you also. Thank you for those messages. The family is going to put the prayer. Great times in the family of God, the beauty of the people throughout the world. The reason for that we bring a great victory is
thank you.